Hi, folks. This is Dr. John Acquaviva. This is an encore presentation of Faith in Sport.
If you recognize this music, then you know it's Faith and Sport time on the Carolina Catholic Radio Network. We're coming to you 1270 AM, Carolina Catholic Radio Charlotte, also streaming at carolinacatholicmedia.org and on the Carolina Catholic Media app. We're also broadcasting across Radio Maria, so glad to have all of our Radio Maria listeners tuned in for a brand new edition of Faith and Sport. I'm Chris, the producer of the show, and now without further ado, here he is. You know him as the host of Faith and Sport, FS Man, Dr. John Acquaviva.
Hey, folks, welcome to the show. However, whenever, wherever you're joining us, we're just glad that you're joining us. This is Faith and Sport. You're listening to Carolina Catholic Radio, a co-production of Radio Maria. Faith and Sport, where we apply our faith to all aspects of sport. So whether you are an athlete, in other words, you're on the field or on the court, whether you're coaching people on the field or on the court, whether you're a parent or grandparent of those people on the field or on the court, this show is for you. Whether you're administrator, referee, this is it. This show is for you.
Or a Catholic.
That's right. We got to bring that back, the Catholic of the
yes.
week. Very good. Good memory on that one, brother.
Yes. You're the one that invented it, the Catholic.
I think I did invent that. It's one of the few things I can register trademark. What do you have to go through to trademark something, by the way? Brother, how you doing?
I'm doing great. I turned another year older over the weekend.
Did you really?
Yes,
God bless you. And you came through some bad weather to get here.
Brother, yes, a monsoon.
Brother, let me tell you something. On my little gadget here called a phone, I heard the biggest buzz I've ever heard. Like, it was a screeching sound.
Wow.
And it kind of scared me. This was about 10 minutes before you got here. And I looked and it said, a tornado warning has been issued for your area. Go to the basement. Of course, first thing I did was I went and asked Brant.
Yeah, because we do have a basement.
That's right. We do have a basement. I go, Brant, should we go to? He goes, let me check where this thing's going on. But apparently it's north of here in Cabarrus County.
Yeah.
Am I saying that right?
Yeah, Cabarrus.
Cabarrus, yeah. And Cabarrus County,
mm-hmm.
Which is kind of north of here. And I think that it was just the conditions for that's what a warning is. A watch is when they actually spot it, right? Do I have that right?
Yeah, the warning is when they've actually seen one. The watch is like when the conditions are right for one.
Oh, so it was a warning. So they did spot one then. Oh, holy smokes.
I'm just glad I didn't spot it coming up Interstate 85.
Yeah,
I wouldn't
exactly.
want to
you might
run
not be
into
here.
Those. Yeah.
But we got started a few minutes late, but here we are anyway. So
yes,
it's all good.
That's right.
It's good stuff. Folks, listen, you're listening to Faith and Sport. Here's what we're going to do today. We're going to talk today's sports topics, including our hit and miss with Carlos Herrera. He's going to join us in 1 minute. We're going to do this week's headlines. After the break, Carlos is going to join us for a few more minutes. We're going to do a quick Q&A with Dr. A. And somewhere in there, we're going to answer the question, can there be too much Tiger Woods coverage? We're going to answer
that's a good question.
I know. In fact, I can't wait to answer this. I'm just excited to get into it right now. But it's going to be a little teaser, right? We'll talk about it a little later.
Yeah.
But anyway, things are good on my end, brother.
That's good.
I'm off for the summer now.
Wow.
Isn't that
awesome.
Great?
Yeah.
In fact, is the first time because our kids are 11, 10, 9, 6, and then a 1-year-old little monkey. And it was interesting because for the first time, my 11-year-old just goes, lucky, right? Like, because she goes, Dad, you're home today. And it was the very first day I was home for this past week. And I said, why do you say that? And she goes, you're off the rest of the summer. And I thought, this is the first time they actually realized that. Because they just, they see Daddy home all the time during the summer. They never really figured out why I was there. But now she realizes, this guy doesn't really have a job. But actually, I do have a job. I'm doing internships, but it's all through the internet, that crazy thing called email. So I don't have to actually go into the school for a couple more months. So I'm enjoying the heck out of it.
Well, they should know that you do have a job. It's the biggest job of anybody,
which
the
is
host of Faith and
Faith
Sport.
Faith and Sport, brother. I love being here. I'm glad you're here. I'm glad that Brant's here. I'm glad the studio's here. I'm glad that we have David Papandrea on board, the hardest working man. You know, they say the hardest working man in show business. He's the hardest working man in Catholic radio.
That's
Wouldn't
right.
you agree with that?
That's right. We're all going to have a big job coming up in the end of June.
That's
during
right.
the big Carolina Catholic Radio fundraiser.
By the way, folks, just to let you know, one of the things that we're going to do is we're going to have giveaways.
That's
and
right.
And I have about 10 Wingate sports related T-shirts, and some of them are dry fit. In other words, it says Wingate Tennis, Wingate Basketball, Wingate Volleyball, all these, and they're yours if you make a donation of a certain amount. I think it's going to be a relatively modest amount.
And can they even get an officially autographed John Aqua Viva Wingate
that,
T-shirt?
I don't want to ruin that T-shirt by brother by giving. By putting my signature on it.
Yeah, no, as soon as they
I'll consider it.
As soon as they win one of those T-shirts, they turn around and sell it on eBay.
Now, if it sold for a decent amount of money, I'd be quite proud. I'd be happy for everybody involved.
Yeah.
Well, listen, I mentioned Carlos Herrera. Man, he's a longtime good friend of mine. He's a certified soccer coach. He's a former, like me, a former youth director at his parish in Northern Virginia. And he joins us once a month to chat about things, all things sport. He's going to talk about our hit and miss, or talk about a hit and miss, as well as other stuff. Let's bring him on the show right now. Carlos Herrera, welcome, buddy.
Thanks for having me on, guys.
I didn't hear the crowd cheer. There's some pause there. What's going on?
Oh, yeah. I guess they got caught in the rain.
That's right. The crowd got hit by a tornado. That's a shame, kind of. It's a terrible thing to even think about. Buddy, how you doing this week?
Doing great.
Are you?
Back on air with you.
Oh, yeah. No, this is great. I always look forward to Mondays. Either you're here, Ed's here, and some days they're both here, aren't they,
Chris?
Right. I remember there's been a few times the guests had to cancel or they had to switch the date, and Ed comes on for the second half of the show, or Carlos has done it. Buddy, I appreciate everything you do, all the preparation you do for this show. Let's get started in our conversation, because you and I had a really, I would say, not heated, but what's the term? A motivated
difference of opinion.
Well, we had a difference of opinion for sure, but there was energy behind our conversation about some things going on in the world of sport. I can't wait to get into it. Let's get into it right now, buddy.
It's like we call it a heated debate.
No, yeah, it was a really good debate. I loved it. And Carlos and I don't always agree on these things in sport. We agree on so many things, Lolitos and I. But on this particular issue about the horse racing, we differ a little bit, but still, it's going to be a good conversation. Buddy, one of the things that you and I do every time we get together, we do our hit and miss, and that is something good or bad, positive or negative in the world of sport. It doesn't have to necessarily do with our faith. Sometimes it does, sometimes it doesn't, but you're up first as always. What's your hit or miss for the week here on Faith and Sport this week?
Well, I'm going to bring in my son. I have a boy, and he's turning 5 this week, and I had gotten him a children's Catholic Bible.
Love it.
And it's the same one that I got when I was a kid. And so we've been reading it at night, and the story of David and Goliath is one that I just read to him. And unfortunately, this Bible isn't written for kids. It has pictures in it and illustrations, but it literally talks about killing, and because we're talking about the Old Testament, right, a lot of the fun stories are there. So David and Goliath, great story, but it reminded me of this particular hit for this week, and that is, if those of you, this past Saturday was the running of the Preakness, which is the second leg of the Triple Crown.
Yep.
And as everybody knows, having a Triple Crown winner is almost a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to see a horse to win all three.
That's right.
And in this particular case, I think many people have heard it, but in the Kentucky Derby, which is the first running of the Triple Crown, there was a horse who wasn't even in the race who got substituted at the very last moment because there was a scratch from one of the horses that were in there. I think it was 20-some-odd horses. One of them scratched, and this was a call-up. And literally, the horse's name is Rich Strike, and this horse had odds of 80-1 to win. His win loss ratio was 1-7. Right, he had only won once in 7 races. The owner had bought him for $30,000, just not because he wanted to buy a Derby winning horse, but he just thought the horse was good, and he thought that in horse racing you buy horses just to train them and to run them and to see how they fare. But rarely do you feel like you're buying a Derby-winning horse. Anyway, this 80-1-odd horse ends up running from the back of the pack, looking like an 80-1 horse, so much so that the announcers don't even pay attention to him until about 100 feet from the end of the winner's, like, the tape, right, where the camera is. This horse passes everybody, including the favorite, who was at the time, the favorite is Epicenter.
Yep.
And the announcer doesn't even mention until he says, Rip strike coming on the outside. Oh my gosh! Oh my gosh! He wins the Kentucky Derby.
That's right. He probably didn't know what the name of the horse was.
Unbelievable.
It was great. It was great, brother. There's no doubt.
And it makes you think of, you know, David and Goliath. And there's so much we could talk about in horse racing related to this.
Yeah.
Because he didn't run in the Preakness. They actually kept the horse out to, quote unquote, save the horse for the Belmont, which is a longer race. But anyway, there's a lot there that we could talk about. But I just thought it was fun. Some of my nephews who's families in horse racing, like they bet.
Yeah.
So the whole family, there's six kids, very Catholic family. They all put very Catholic betting family, just like yours, John. Right? and they, some of them bet the 80-1 horse with, I think it was $5, and they would have come out winning something like $450.
Oh yeah, they would have won a lot of money. You know what that's like, man. You had. At a derby party you and I both attended over a decade ago. I think we talked about this on the air when you weren't here. Ed and I did, with Giacomo, and he was 50-1.
It was like 68-1 or 58-1.
And it was great because our mutual friend Charlie, who's been a guest on this show, he's in the seminary and he's been a guest.
Very Catholic. As
oh
well,
yeah, yeah. Of course, he's in the seminary. Yeah, yeah, exactly. They're they might have put a wager or two on a horse race or two in the past, but they didn't go through a bookie. They just accepted the money and they just distributed the odds and so forth. And I thought
they were not happy with me because they more than what they expected.
But if I remember correctly, you only put $5 on it. Is that right?
I think I probably put $5 on. I put it on probably two or three horses.
Yeah, and one of them was Giacomo. And one of the reasons I like Giacomo is that is a fairly common first name of a male Italian, right? Yeah, Italiano nome. All right, folks, you're listening to Faith and Sport here on Carolina Catholic Radio. This is a co-production of Radio Maria. This is Faith and Sport, where we look at sport through a Catholic lens. Carlos Herrera is joining us. Joins us just about every other show, and right now we're talking about our hit and miss in the world of sport, and his hit is Rich Strike, a horse, an 80-1 horse who won a couple weeks ago in the Kentucky Derby. Now, the irony was, this past weekend was the Preakness, the second leg of the Triple Crown. He had a chance to not only win that race, but to win two-thirds of the Triple Crown, but he was pulled. But you know, I'm going to leave our listeners suspended on that one, Carlos. We're going to come back to that after the break here in a little bit. So I want to get to my hit or miss. And by the way, Carlos, I think that's neat. That's certainly one of the neatest things you can do with your children is read scripture to them. You know, that's something that we try to do. I sense, though, and I've only talked to Max a couple times, but I sense he's a really smart kid.
He is. The other day, I think his aunt told him the story of Meshach.
Oh, yeah, the three big names.
Three.
Yeah.
The three guys, Meshach.
And, Tarak and Winnebago. Yeah, I know there's.
Yeah, anyway, I asked him yesterday in front of my brother, who just got back from a Catholic mission trip, which is also an amazing opportunity to do with your family. Anyway, he said, I go, what are the three guys that got put in the furnace? And he goes, it was Meshach, whatever, Rorschach, and Abednego. And then he goes, and Jesus. And I go, yeah, he was in there too. Right?
Jesus is in everybody's heart, brother. So if, you know, Winnebago's going somewhere, Jesus is going with them. Hey, listen, folks.
For our Protestants out there and our Bible thumpers.
Yeah.
That comes from the first book of Samuel, chapter 17, if you would like to read about David and Goliath.
Oh, there you go. I appreciate that, brother. Listen, folks, I promised that we'd get to our hit and miss. We're going to have to do it right after the break, though. Whenever we hear that music, that means we're going into break. Hang with us here on Faith and Sport. I'm Dr. John Acquaviva. Be right back.
Dr. Giacomo Acquaviva.
Carolina Catholic News. Quo Vadis days. Where are you going? Belmont Abbey College is once again offering a five-day vocation discernment camp for young men June 14th to June 18th. This retreat challenges men ages 15 through 19 to find out what God's will has for their life. A well-balanced program awaits participants, which includes summer camp activities and fellowship, as well as Mass, Liturgy of the Hours, Eucharistic Adoration, and an interaction with priests and seminarians. The cost for this exceptional event is $150, which includes lodging at the college, meals, and supplies. Financial assistance may be available. Registration has begun. For details, contact Father Brian Becker at bjbecker@charlottediocese.org. For the Carolina Catholic News, I'm Pam Cullen. God bless y'all.
Do you have a desire to conform your life more closely to Jesus Christ? Are you longing for a richer, deeper spiritual life while living in the world? Do you want greater spiritual discipline? Do you want to walk along a well-trod path of sanctification and holiness? Would you like to be part of a religious order that has a strong devotion to the Blessed Virgin Mary? Would you like to dedicate your life to liturgical and contemplative prayer and the study of sacred truth, sharing the fruits thereof with others? Do you find within you a holy zeal to fight for truth and justice? Do you have a strong desire for the salvation of souls, to take them by the hand and teach them? Do you want to join the Church's mission of preaching the truth of Christ as He revealed to His holy Church? If all this sounds like you, we invite you to contact the Charlotte Lay Dominicans at our website, charlottelaydominicans.org. That's charlottelaydominicans.org. We look forward to meeting you.
I can listen to that song. That is awesome song. Do you know who that is, by the way?
Yeah, R.E.M.
I know. It's called Texarkana. It's one of my favorite songs by them. Awesome. Folks, welcome back to Faith and Sport. I'm Dr. John Aquaviva. I teach exercise science right down the road there. Every time I say that, I point in the direction of Wingate. Chris is the only one that can see that. But I'm not doing that right now. Right now, I'm doing Faith and Sport here on Carolina Catholic Radio. It's a co-production of Radio Maria. And Carlos Herrera is on the line. He's a certified soccer coach. He's a former youth director like I am. And he's joining us right now for our conversation on the hit and miss. And he talked about his hit from a couple weeks ago, the big Rich Strike winning at 80-1 odds, the Kentucky Derby. But we're going to pick on little Rich Strike here in a couple minutes. We're going to come back to that. And Carlos is going to defend him. So be careful. By the way, coming up, we have our this week's headlines. And we're going to address the question, can there be too much Tiger Woods coverage?
I can go ahead and answer that.
No, I'm going to answer that. You and I can answer that together. We can answer it in one word, by the way, so I'm kind of giving away our answer. And at the end of the show, we're going to do the quick Q&A with Dr. A. By the way, this is a special show for a couple reasons. First of all, Carlos is joining us, but he's going to join us for a few minutes more than he normally joins us, and I can't wait to pick apart his brain. So, Carlos, it's time for my hit or miss of the week, and mine is a hit. But it seemingly seems like a negative thing. It happened in the state of Texas, in Austin, Texas. It was a Little League game, and it was a video of an umpire at a Little League game addressing the fans directly behind home plate. And, of course, it's like any other Little League game. You can kind of sense there's maybe 30 or 40 people there. Virtually everybody in the stands is probably a family member of somebody on the field, and they're giving him a hard time, this home plate umpire, about balls and strikes. Now, this is problematic for a couple reasons. First of all, these people can't really see. Even if they're directly behind the plate, they can't really see what the ball is doing and exactly where it goes over the plate. And even if they could have a good vantage point, they are not the umpire. If they want to be the referee, then put on a whistle and get the little striped shirt and get the little equipment and you go do it yourselves and you go earn $45 per game and you get yelled at by some little league people or even some big league people. The reason that this is a hit is that he warned these people, Carlos, behind the plate to stop basically heckling him. He was professional about it. He was clearly frustrated. By the way, this video is easily accessible via that thing called the internet. And he says to them, just stop calling balls and strikes. Stop getting on me about that. Just try to enjoy the game. Let's get back to the game. And they keep giving him a hard time. Eventually, he says, listen, if you guys keep this up, I am going to forfeit this game. And, of course, usually that works. The people kind of see themselves. That's a way for the umpire or the referee to put up like a mirror in front of the fans, and in particular these parents. And then they say, yeah, you know what? I don't want this game to end. This umpire has the authority to end this game. And Carlos, the next time they said something to him, he goes, game over. And he looks at the kids on the field and he goes, game over. Now, I think this is a hit. And the reason is because it's just one more example of the parents overstepping their bounds. First of all, they generally don't know what they're talking about. But even if they do know what they're talking about, let the umpire and let his authority rule the game. He's not perfect. He's making $45, maybe $70. Somewhere in between there is the usual pay. But get this, Carlos. He was a member of that community, and he's a firefighter in that very community. Shame on those people. I'm glad he ended that game. Those people need to put things in perspective. Your thoughts on what I just said?
It's hard for me to see it as a hit when, you know, I think once a month we have a scenario where we bring up where a parent or multiple parents are not behaving themselves at youth sporting games.
Yeah.
Like it is unbelievable to me.
Yeah.
I will say to your listeners, if you're going to look it up, there is some swear words that I believe the umpire said because he was just so tired of it.
Mm.
But the reality of it is that, you know, and I was thinking about this after watching it, like, and I would love to be a ref. I know, John, that you were a ref
For rugby.
And, mm-hmm. and be curious as to your experience of fans in the games you coached or refed and how players reacted. But in youth sports, this should never be a part of youth sports.
That's
parents
right.
should not be allowed. And I thought, you know, can you eject a kid? Right, whose parent that is, right? And you say, "I'm sorry, but you know your kid's gone." But clearly, when you cancel the game for both teams, there's peer pressure here now that somebody on those teams, either one of those teams, should have something where that parent that created that issue doesn't go to another game, or somebody's in charge of controlling that parent.
So let me ask you this. As you might remember, you and I met on the rugby field at George Mason University a few years ago. And after about a 15-year career for me, I switched my jersey from a player's jersey to a referee jersey, and I got certified and so forth. And one of the things that was made known to us almost from the beginning is that you are the judge and the jury at a rugby game. But the thing is we were never asked to forfeit the game, but what we were encouraged to do, if a fan, a parent, anybody, even a player or a coach, was being inappropriate toward the game itself, or in particular toward the referee, we had the right to remove them from the field, or the game wouldn't continue. And I never had to do it, but I've been at games where referees did have to do that because the person was just simply out of hand. They were being inappropriate. They were being vulgar. They were being unfair, whatever. Sometimes all three of those things. And they would remove them from the field. And usually they would give them a couple minutes. But the good thing about that, Carlos, is often whichever team was associated with that individual, the coach of that team and the players of that team would go over there and they would talk them into being wise and just go stand over there. And the referee would often designate a spot, like you have to be in the parking lot, you have to be on that hill, you have to be over here, you cannot be anywhere near. So even if you were to yell, I cannot hear you and the players cannot hear you. I kind of wish that's what that umpire would have done. And I am sorry because I kind of directed people toward this video and I didn't recall him swearing. But yeah, Carlos, I'm glad you mentioned that as a warning to if anybody watches it. But it's interesting because you said you didn't necessarily think it was a hit, but you did kind of chastise the bad sportsmanship in parents. And I think ultimately that's what they were addressing. So I understand where you're coming from.
Yeah, certainly it's a hit from the perspective of the referee taking control of the game and chastising the parent and every parent there and the kids, right? That
yeah.
There's a lesson there. So that's definitely a hit. For me, what I mean is, I don't understand why parents bring this attitude and other parents don't say, you know, Joe, be quiet, right? You're going to get this game terminated, right? Well, like, to me, it's a miss in the parents. And the parents' behavior and responsibility. I mean, for a referee to have to deal with, you know, reffing the game, understanding the rules, keeping the play going, managing sort of the character of the game that's going, and then have to deal with unruly parents on the sideline, to me, is definitely not the role and the job that the referee has. And I don't understand where the other parents are and where the coaches are.
So, and what do you mean by that? So, in other words, maybe it's the responsibility to a degree for the opposite or for the parents in the stands, especially if they know them, to go, hey, come on. Like,
absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely.
I get that.
Hey, Joe, you know, shut your mouth.
You know? No, but
like, where's the coach? Why doesn't the coach say, hey, you're going to get this game canceled for all the kids? I mean, when somebody's angry, you know this. The referee drew a line in the sand, and they always say this in politics, and you can see it today. Never draw a line in the sand because people will cross it just because they're angry. And he said, if you keep it up, I'm canceling this game. And what does the guy do? The parent just keeps it up.
Yeah.
You know, game canceled for all those 22 kids, you know, that wanted to go out and play.
Well, brother, because this is a Christian atmosphere, we have Christian listeners. This is on Catholic radio. And the good thing about Catholic radio is I've heard anywhere between 10 and 30% of all listeners are Christian, but they're not faithful Catholics. So they don't belong to the Catholic faith, but they listen to Catholic radio anyway because I think they appreciate the word that it delivers. And along those lines, I know the answer to the question, and so do you. In other words, you asked, why do these people do this? Why can't they master themselves and just be quiet? It's pride, brother. They are wrapped up in their child's winning and losing. They feel like a winner if their child wins. And when they berate the umpire, they feel that somehow, some way, he's going to make calls that benefit them more than the other team. It's pride, brother. And this is a very powerful thing. And I mentioned this just a couple of weeks ago, and I'll probably keep saying it every time it comes up. But a friend that is a priest, at the time he said this, he was a priest of 12 years, and he said, every single confession I have heard, and think about it, Carlos, in 12 years, how many confessions he's heard. He said virtually every sin that people have committed is somehow related to pride. Let me read something from the Catechism, brother, and this is about self-mastery. And part of it is, right, there's integrity, there's honesty, there's a lot of things that are wrapped up here. And this is one of the reasons and explains why people sin and why people mess up in these situations, in particular in sport, as we're talking about. It's 2342 in our catechism. Self-mastery is a long and exacting work. One can never consider it acquired once and for all. It presupposes renewed effort at all stages of life. The effort required can be more intense in certain periods, such as when the personality of being formed during childhood and adolescence. And as in essence, what's so interesting about this piece from the Catechism, Carlos, is it says it's a long and exacting work. In other words, it's a lifelong project. And a lot of it's rooted in when we're younger, right? In adolescence and so forth. And think of it, the reason that is so poignant that the catechism says this is that we become like children at these games, right? We revert back to childish rather than adult behavior. And we kind of give in to sinful behavior rather than virtue. And our pride takes over and it just masters us in that moment.
Pride being such and one of the probably most powerful sins and the most common sin for us as human beings. And I've been trained in coaching kids and youth, and one of the things that they stress, and my perspective was in soccer, being a paid soccer coach and going through some great training about how to be a good soccer coach. One of the components is that all youth for the kids to learn how to play, right? It's not about winning and losing. It's not about who wins. It's about learning to play. And parents don't seem to understand that. You know, at youth sports, I've seen it in Catholic schools where one Catholic school is playing another Catholic school. And I'm talking elementary level, too.
Yeah,
I mean, you can
yeah.
easily see in high school where parents just lose control. Their desire to win and their kids to win is more important than having an environment which is, you know, as if you were playing against Jesus's team.
Of
you
course.
Know, there's 10 members that are all Jesus playing, and your team's like it's unbelievable. It really is distressing, and it's one of my biggest pet peeves as an adult, as a youth, as a coach, as a PE teacher, as a youth minister, is watching the behavior of parents on the sidelines.
I hear you, brother. Listen, folks, you're listening to Carolina Catholic Radio. This is a co-production of Radio Maria. What we're going to do is we're going to go to a break right now. After the break, we're going to do weekend headlines, and we're going to continue our conversation with Carlos Herrera. So stay tuned. You're listening to Faith and Sport. This is where we merge sport and virtue. We'll be right back right after this.
Hello, my name is Ray Haywood, and I'm coming to you today to speak to you about the Fraternity of St. Joseph Men's Group, a men's group that was started under the leadership of Father Matthew Codd by the intentional men of the parish of St. Thomas Aquinas here in our Diocese of Charlotte, North Carolina. In our first efforts, we were asked if we would model our men's group in a way that other parishes could simply follow. With that intent in mind, we created the FSJJourneyman.com website. On that website, you can find all that is needed to create your own chapter of the Fraternity of St. Joseph Men's Group in your parish, as well as resource documents that we are intentionally placing into our faith community. We hope that you will step closer to the path and to each other in the just model of St. Joseph as you consider creating your own chapter of the Fraternity of St. Joseph Men's Group.
. 2022 is bringing many new and exciting changes to our Carolina Catholic Apostolate, built to communicate how to better learn, love, and live our Catholic faith. We begin with our name change to Carolina Catholic Media. This reflects the expanded scope of Carolina Catholic Radio to include the development of our podcast, streaming, social media, YouTube, and direct marketing platforms. 2022 is a very important year for the Catholic Church. As a result, Carolina Catholic Media will feature more local news, information, and conversation to reflect what's happening now and how it impacts our local Catholic community. Throughout the year, Carolina Catholic Media will showcase our Catholic schools and homeschools, the Charlotte Diocese 50th anniversary, and the two-year worldwide synod process that begins on the diocesan level. We encourage you to get involved, join us, and catch the spirit. The Carolina Catholic Media Apostolate is a 501c3 nonprofit. We are 100% funded by you. Please consider a donation, monthly tithe, or business sponsorship to support our mission and vision to spread the truth of Jesus Christ and our Catholic faith across the Carolinas. Thank you for discerning a role in our apostolate. May God bless you abundantly.
If that music's on, we're back on. Folks, well, thank you for joining us today on Faith in Sport, where we apply our faith to all aspects of sport. Thank you for joining us today on Carolina Catholic Radio, a co-production of Radio Maria. Listen, if there is somebody that that you think would be a good guest on the show, they are an athlete, a former athlete, they're a coach, an umpire, and they are in the world of sport, and they are faithful individuals. Well, I want to talk to them. I want to see if they want to be on the show. They probably have a message to give to our listeners. I certainly would like to meet more people that are faithful as well as in the world of sport. That's what our show is all about. So please write me at, or have them write me at, faithandsport@wingate.edu. There's the word AND in there, faith and sport, at Wingate, as in Wingate University, wingate.edu. That's faith and sport at wingate.edu. We're going to continue our conversation with Carlos Herrera in 1 minute, but right now let's do weekend headlines. All right, here's what's going on in the world of sport, at least some of the things. We're in Major League Baseball. We're well into the season now, so let's take a look at MLB.com's power rankings. 1 through 4 are the Yankees, the Dodgers, the Astros, and the Mets. I would say the only slight surprise there are the Mets, but not even. But Chris's Atlanta Braves, in the same division as the Mets, heard some good news this week. Mets pitcher Max Scherzer, one of the league's best, will be out for at least 6 weeks with an injury. Chris, that bring a smile to your face? So yes. Somebody else's pain is your pleasure, is what you're saying.
Yeah, I've got a smile on my face, but inside I'm going, aww.
The Preakness, as we talked about, the surprising story here was Derby winner Rich Strike did not run. But more on that later. In fact, Carlos and I will probably wrap around back to that. But early voting won this race, and that took place in Baltimore. The third leg of the Triple Crown, by the way, will be in a couple weeks with the Belmont Stakes that is in New York. In the NHL, we're in the second round of the playoffs, which means there are 8 teams remaining. The big story is regular season best record Florida Panthers are down 3-0 in their series with the Tampa Bay Lightning. If you want to know why hockey sticks around as a legitimate sport, watch playoff hockey. It's terrific. So there you have it, folks. Sports news that may or may not change your life. Listen, folks, if you're just joining us, we're about halfway through the show here, Faith and Sport on Carolina Catholic Radio, a co-production of Radio Maria. If you're joining us for the first time, which I guess is possible, right, Chris? At some point, somebody has to be a listener for the first time.
That's right.
Right?
Because we have so many listeners around our listening area, and being nationally syndicated, we have new listeners all the time.
All the time. So, Chris, let me ask you, if your gal, your mom or dad or somebody says, what's that show Faith and Sport about? How do you sum it up? What is our show about?
I tell them that we talk talk some sports, and then we also talk about our faith and have a lot of fun mixed in.
I like that. That's very succinct. Very good.
Yeah.
I'm not sure I could put it any better than that. Either way, folks, welcome to the show, especially if it's your first time. Special welcome, and keep coming back. And
that's
by the
right.
way, Chris, if they want to listen to previous shows, all they have to do is go to CarolinaCatholicRadio.org.
Well, actually, it's CarolinaCatholicMedia.org now, and
we
Carolina Catholic Media app. And make sure when you do go to the Faith and Sport archive to listen to your favorite Faith and Sport shows, to hit the Donate Now button to make a donation to Carolina Catholic Media and Carolina Catholic Radio to keep great programs like Faith and Sport on the air and other great programs that we have on Carolina Catholic Radio and Carolina Catholic Media as well.
All right, let me ask you this then, Chris. For weeks I've been saying now, CarolinaCatholicRadio.org. In fact, just recently I gave this address out. If they put in CarolinaCatholicRadio.org, wouldn't it take them directly to that website still?
Yes, yeah, okay. It'll still take them to the website. It's just we've renamed everything to Carolina Catholic Media to kind of cover
everything
radio,
that we do.
Podcasting,
yeah.
All the stuff that we do.
Well, if we're going to change the name, we should have changed it to Carolina Catholic Radio. CarolinaCatholicAquaman.org.
Yeah.
That wouldn't have been a bad name. All right, listen, we have Carlos Herrera on the line. Carlos, I want to give you the final say on this refereeing thing, and what is your suggestion to people, and I mean this literally, because I know ultimately you're going to say sit on your hands, but what is your recommendation to them in preparation for the game? Is prayer going to help? Is talking to their pastor going to help? If they bring a negative attitude or negative kind of vibe to the world of sport when they go to their little son or daughter's game, what is your recommendation to them to keep that atmosphere positive?
Well, it's interesting. I think that's a great question. You know, in some states, they are creating laws that you will be penalized, with a misdemeanor or a felony. Verbally assault or intimidate a referee. I am not in that place where I think you need a law for that. But
yeah.
I do think, and what was the last time that you heard from the pulpit a conversation about, like, behavior of adults and kids, right? You can easily lump it together. Yeah. But I think adults need to hear this. I mean, many times I've been in church, and we do talk about history and the past and the et cetera. But there are some relevant opportunities here. Be like Jesus in the stands of a game and to witness, and not only witness, but to be a stand and to kind of do the right thing, if you will, and to get up and have some courage and challenge somebody who is a peer, who is misbehaving. And I think you could do that from the pulpit. I think there definitely should be a conversation before the game. You know how they bring the captains together?
Yeah.
I think the coaches should be brought together and the captains and go, this is how we're going to play the game. If there's any misbehaving parents, you as a coach are responsible for it. If you don't control your parents, then the next step is going to be, I'm either going to toss the parent, and if you can't do that, then I'm suspending the game. You understand the rules? This is how we're going to do it. Blah, blah, blah. Coaches say, yeah. And that's another thing you do, right? And then everybody knows and understands it, and the coach can go back and tell the parent. That's how I did it with when I was coaching. For one, the league would emphasize this. And as parents, well, as coaches, we were instructed to go take a course on, if you can believe it, being good, what is the term?
Like stewards of the game or something.
Yeah, it was like a positive, what is this? It was like positive coaching, right? Like this whole being classified so that winning wasn't emphasized as the only metric for being a good coach.
No, of course.
Right? And I think adults need to sign something. If your kid's going to play, there should be some sort of, you know, like they do in school, your kid has to sign this, you know, behavior affidavit, if you will. Parents should sign something like that too for sports.
So let me say this, Carlos. If you took a poll, if you did a survey on thousands of people that are involved in youth sport, my guess it would come out something like this. If you asked 1,000 people, who is the biggest culprit of bad sportsmanship, or who's the most guilty of bad sportsmanship at a typical youth sport game, my guess is it would come out 70-20-10, 70% of the surveyed people would say it's parents, 20% would say it's the coaches, and 10% would say it's the referees and the players themselves. And what's interesting, the reason that number is so big, I would think, and I think you would agree with that, would you have any change in those numbers? Remember, we're speaking hypothetically here. Would you have any change in those numbers?
I think it's, when it comes to referees and players, I think it's like 5%. I think it's very
tiny.
Low.
Yeah.
I think coaches is probably higher. I think maybe it's 20% coaches. And then I think it's higher for adults, right? Like it's probably 30% coaches and maybe 40% parents.
Got it.
Right?
So even still, you and I would agree, even though we're different, we differ on the percentages, that the highest percentage of this pie would go to the parents, right? They display the most incidences of bad sportsmanship. If you think about it from this way, I think it helps explain it. Think about the coaches, the referees or the umpires, and the players. They all have something at stake. Their reputations are more public. They want to stay in coaching usually. That's usually a big incentive. I think you and I would agree, brother, there are thousands of volunteer coaches who do a good job and they never get any press of any sort because they ultimately do a good job or at least a good enough job. The players themselves have something on the line. They can get kicked off the team. They can get suspended from the team. But think about what, Carlos, is the penalty for bad sportsmanship from a parent? There virtually is none. Yes, they can be, I don't know, have some type of misdemeanor slapped on them by a local cop, but I think that's a rare instance. I think ultimately there's no kind of I don't know, penalty that can come upon them, and I think that states to a degree why they overreact and why pride is such a big factor. Everybody else in that circle has just as much pride. The player, the coach, the referee, they all have pride too. But there's something at stake. There's something inherently, there's an inherent kind of consequence. Whereas with the parent, it's vague, right? I think there's something to be said about that.
I think there's a great point there, and I think that's where peer pressure, you know, adults, you know, if he, like this ref in this video, when he cancels the game, there are 11 kids on each side of the field, right?
Yep.
So there's going to be at least 11 parents at a minimum or close to it. So that's a lot of people, and if both parents are there, then you have even more. But there's got to be peer pressure that my kid just practiced all week and this game was canceled because you couldn't keep your mouth shut.
Yeah.
Right? That should be the peer pressure that should exist. And many times, you know, I think it'd be interesting to say, you know, out of those parents that are that way, you know, how many are men versus how many are women? Like, is it more likely that men are adversarial in that regard? Or is it women? Like, we saw the softball video from a month ago,
yeah,
where a woman just was berating a female ref.
Yeah.
You know, and punched the ref. So, you know.
It was an umpire, yeah.
Ironic.
I know. Yeah. No, it's terrible stuff. Listen, we're coming up to the break in 2 minutes. But before we go, there's something I want to mention. One of the big things in the world of sport, I truly think this was one of the biggest announcements in the world of sport. Certainly, it made a splash in within a circle of fans of soccer. But it was announced that both the men's and women's United States soccer federations were going to split any profits down the middle. And I was really surprised by this. I'd love to get your view because you're a soccer guy as much as anything else, as much as any other sport. But every story that I read about this continued to harp on the following, that the women's team, the women's national team, has won and has done far more and has had far more success, I should say, in World Cup play and in international play than have the men's. But the difference is, and there have been some articles, Carlos, that even refuse to mention the difference in revenue that is generated from, for instance, the men's World Cup versus the Women's World Cup. I want to get your view on this. We only have 1 minute to go, but I want to share this particular piece of data. The most recent World Cups, the Women's World Cup generated $96 million. The men's, $5.4 billion. That's with the B as in Bill. We have about 45 seconds left. I'm going to give you the last comment on this, brother.
Wow, 45 seconds to tackle this subject. I definitely think it should be based on, you know, how much the World Cup brings in, right? It's a basic, you know, finances, right?
Yeah, like it is.
You bring in, whatever, $95 million, you know, you're probably dividing amongst less teams than in the World Cup, the Men's World Cup. So I think that has to be taken into account. I think there's, as a percentage, like if the men's are getting, I don't know, 10% of whatever the country gets for the fee, then the women should be able to get 10% of that.
Yeah, exactly.
Right? Like, I think there's different ways of what is equal. Is it equal percentage? Is it equal dollar amount, right?
Yeah.
And I think that could be argued, and it should be.
Yeah, no, I appreciate that, brother. Listen, I know you had a lot more to say about this. We had a great conversation. I appreciate you so much. Thank you for taking time out. You are a busy guy with H3 renovations there in the Northern Virginia area. Brother, I appreciate your input and all that you put into the show. Thank you from Faith in Sport, brother.
Thanks for having me on. And if there's one way that we can keep one parent from restraining their tone and their language, then we've done a little bit to make sports more faith-like and more Jesus-like. So glad to be a part of this.
I appreciate
again,
that, brother.
John, have a great show.
You too. Thank
Lolitos!
You. Lolitos! There he is, Carlos Herrera, a certified soccer coach from Northern Virginia, also a former youth director. He's got a lot of experience in everything we talk about. I appreciate everything that he brings to the show. Folks, you're listening to Faith in Sport here on Carolina Catholic Radio. It's a co-production of Radio Maria. We've got one more segment coming up, so stick with us. We're going to break right now, but we'll be right back.
Hi, this is Gail Buckley Barringer, a.k.a. the Bible Lady. How many times have you been asked questions about your faith, such as where is purgatory in the Bible, or why do Catholics pray to Mary? Wouldn't it be nice to be able to point to these answers right in your Bible? Well, you can. The Catholic Scripture Study Bible has an extra 76 pages of information on our faith, including answers to many questions such as these, with Bible verses under each subject that you can turn to right there in your Bible for the answers. There are several articles as well about dreams in the Bible, the devil, end times, and more. In addition, I compiled a topical and index with many subjects, including gossip, angels, and even tattoos, with Bible verses related to these topics as well. The Catholic Scripture Study Bible is beautiful and would make a great gift for Easter, graduation, weddings, or any occasion. It can be found in bookstores nationwide on the publisher's website as well as Amazon.com.
Hey guys, it's Jason Murphy for the Obligation Radio Show. Make sure to tune in on Friday afternoons at 5 p.m. to catch our latest episodes. From kids to marriage to business and church to politics to current events, we discuss topics of faith and life to help you become the man, the father, the husband God is calling you to be. Catch replays streaming throughout the week and on demand over the Carolina Catholic Radio app or anytime at carolinacatholicradio.org. God bless and esto vir.
Hey, folks, welcome back. This is Faith in Sport. I'm Dr. John Acquaviva. You're listening to Carolina Catholic Radio, a co-production of Radio Maria. Listen, I mentioned earlier, if you have an idea for the show, if you have a guest, somebody that would be a great guest on the show, is faithful, but and they're involved in the world of sport, they can be anywhere in the country, anybody, anywhere in the world. We'd love to have them on the show. You can email me at faithandsport@wingate.edu. Again, A-N-D is in there. faithandsport@wingate.edu. Or you could tweet me. I haven't mentioned this in a while, Chris. I love to say this. You could tweet me at j.aquaviva1. That's the number one. j.aquaviva1. And I'm going to say it right for the first time. If you want to listen to this show or a previous show, all you have to do is go to carolinacatholicmedia.org.
That's right.
Man, I got it right for the first time.
Or the Carolina Catholic Media app.
There you go. I'm so glad you're here. I was
just download it to your phone absolutely free of charge.
Don't tell anybody, Chris. I don't really know what the app
means. For the first time, then you have to pay for the rest of the times. No, I'm just kidding. It's always free.
Do you spell app with one P or two P's?
A-P-P.
Hey, folks, listen, here's what we're going to do. This is our final segment of the show. I hope you enjoyed it up until this point. I've really enjoyed today's show.
Yeah.
I don't know, maybe for more... Maybe at a higher level than other shows. I don't know. I tend to enjoy all of them. But here's what we're going to do. We're going to talk about the Nick Saban and Jimbo Fisher saga. This is a true saga.
Oh, yeah.
Did you hear about this? Okay.
To the clip we're going to play here. And boy, Jimbo
it's really
is
a shame.
Pretty upset.
It's kind of sad, isn't it?
Yeah.
And we're going to answer the question, can there be too much Tiger Woods coverage? I can't wait to answer this question.
Me too.
Chris, I know you want to answer too. And we're going to end with a quick Q&A with Dr. A. So... let's first talk about the Nick Saban and Jimbo Fisher saga, what's going on. Okay, for people that have no background or only very little background on this, let's talk about something before we play this clip from Jimbo Fisher at this press conference. Nick Saban is the head coach of Alabama Crimson Tide football. Jimbo Fisher is a former Alabama Crimson Tide football assistant under Nick Saban. He's now the coach at Texas A&M. Texas A&M not only had the best recruiting class, people that are freshmen coming in this fall, that they've ever had. It's one of the best recruiting classes that anybody has ever had, right? All these super seniors, right? Guys that had great high school careers have signed on the dotted line, have committed to Texas A&M. Now, there's something called NIL, N-I-L, name, image, and likeness. And this was, it's only a year old. In fact, it's not even quite a year old. The name, image, and likeness was the first of its kind in NCAA history in which businesses could pay these college students in any sport an unlimited amount of money for them to be a spokesman or something similar with their company. So, for instance, if I own John's Car Wash and I have five of them in Ann Arbor, Michigan, I would say, Chris, how about you're my starting quarterback? I'll give you $50,000 a year for you to be on a billboard promoting my car washes. And you say, absolutely, sir. And by the way, you can sign with me and 10 other companies to make up to, it's an unlimited amount, right? It opened up this huge can of worms in the world of sport. Mm-hmm. Nick Saban did not like the fact that Jimbo Fisher, his former assistant, had such a good recruiting class. And ultimately what he said was,
you paid those people to go there. He said this publicly. Chris, he said, the guy at Texas A&M, referring to Jimbo Fisher, paid them to come there. In other words, there wasn't really any nil contract or, you know, agreement going on. They just ultimately said, we're going to give you this much money. And, of course, the irony is they can do that. These guys don't have to do anything. All they have to do is take a picture with, you know, Charlie the car wash monkey, you know, their little, you know, logo. And meanwhile, they get sometimes literally hundreds of thousands of dollars. And by the way, I mentioned this on the show a couple weeks ago. There was an entrepreneur for Eastern Michigan. This is, I don't even know the name of their nickname, right? It's a what's called a directional school. Whatever has east, west, north, or south in it, nobody really knows much about that school. Eastern Michigan University. This entrepreneur offered a quarterback to transfer from Oklahoma to Eastern Michigan $1 million to be the spokesman for this company. $1 million. And the amazing thing is this guy ended up going, this player, Caleb Williams, ended up going to USC instead. How much? I wonder how much he got there.
Yeah.
If he turned down $1 million. Think about that. That's astounding. Mm. You and I would probably be talking about this if we were $100,000.
Yeah.
Right? So Nick Saban, I think, is a little sour at the fact that this guy has a really good recruiting class coming in, and he ultimately used this opportunity to disparage and ultimately insult this name, image, and likeness thing because he doesn't like it like so many coaches because it comes a bidding war. Nick Saban, a couple days ago, this has just happened in the last couple days, had a press conference in which he addressed Nick Saban's comments. Right. Let's listen to it.
Last night in Alabama?
Yes, I would. First of all, I'll say it's a shame that we have to do this. It's really despicable. It's despicable that somebody can say things about somebody and an organization. More importantly, 17-year-old kids. You're taking shots at 17-year-old kids and their families. That they broke state laws. They're all money. We bought every player on this group. We never bought anybody. No rules were broken. Nothing was done wrong. It was all in the way we do things, the ethics in which we do things. And these families, it's despicable that a reputable head coach could come out and say this when he doesn't get his way or things don't go his way. The narcissist in him doesn't allow those things to happen. And it's ridiculous. But when he's not on top and the parity in college football he's been talking about, go talk to coaches who coach for him. You'll find out all the parity. Go dig into wherever he's been. You can find out anything. And it's a shame that you got to sit here and defend 17-year-old kids and families and Texas A&M because we do things right. We're always going to do things right. But we're always going to be here. We're doing a heck of a job. These coaches have done a great job. Our players have done a great job. The whole organization of recruiting people. It's despicable that we got to sit here at this level of ball and say these things to defend the people of this organization, the kids, 17-year-old kids, and their families. It's amazing. Some people think they're God. Go dig into how God did his deal. You may find out about a guy that a lot of things you don't want to know. We built him up to be the czar of football. Go dig into his past or anybody that's ever coached with him. You can find out anything you want to find out, what he does and how he does it. And it's despicable. It really is. And it's a shame we have to sit up here and have this conversation about things we do. And it's personal to us? Yes, it is. It's personal to A&M.
All right, so that's, again, Jimbo Fisher, the head coach of Texas A&M, in a press conference just over the last couple of days, in which he is responding to fellow head coach for the Alabama Crimson Tide, Nick Saban, in which Nick Saban basically, he said that the great recruiting class that Texas A&M has coming in under Jimbo Fisher, they were paid, whether they earned it or not through this name, image, and likeness policy, they were just paid. And by the way, a side note before I get into Jimbo Fisher's comments, the NCAA put the first rule that's associated with this nil policy. You cannot use it to lure players in. They must already be on campus. They must already be enrolled at school before they can get. And that makes sense, right? Because then you can't recruit them directly and you can't buy them like Nick Saban's saying. Now, there's two things that are pretty obvious about Jimbo Fisher's comments. He is equally hurt as he is mad. You could hear it in his voice. Yeah. In fact, you could tell he's a sensitive guy, and he may be even on the verge of tears. And I'm not – that's not a bad thing by any means. Just shows that he's a sensitive guy. But I think as much as anything, I'll bet $1 million if you asked him, is Nick Saban a friend of yours, he would say yes. He gave him his start at big-time college football. He went from he went from Alabama to Florida State, did a great job there. Now he's at Texas A&M. He's recruiting well. He'll probably be in a national championship game in the next couple of years just because of this great recruiting he's done. But He is mad, and he is hurt by Nick Saban and Nick Saban's comments. And let me just kind of funnel this into the direction I'm going. So a lot of directions this can go. But Nick Saban has apologized publicly for making those comments. And he meant it toward Jimbo Fisher. He certainly wanted to repair this relationship publicly. But later on, Chris, did you listen to that whole interview?
Yeah.
And in that interview, doesn't he say that he received phone calls from Nick Saban and he refused to take them, and he said he will not take them? Now, folks, that's where what I want to focus on. We all make mistakes. Everybody knows this, right? But the apology is huge. When people lose their pride and they become humble enough to apologize. Now, was his public apology, Nick Saban's, the greatest public apology ever? I probably wouldn't rank it in the top 10. But he did call him too, and that's when it's possible that there would have been more humility on Nick Saban's part. And I mean this with full sincerity. Let's pray for both Nick Saban and Jimbo Fisher, that Jimbo Fisher opens up his mind and opens up his heart to accept that phone call and give Nick Saban a chance to apologize and repair that friendship.
Yeah.
Because this is public now, isn't it? Chris, this isn't just something that is right between the two of them. He didn't say something in a text to him.
No.
That's different. This is public, and this is hurting the world of sport.
Mm-hmm.
And I think Nick Saban, probably for all that he can muster up, all the humility they can muster up, he did a public apology, and then now he's trying to call him. And I ask Jimbo Fisher, and I ask you people to pray for him. Jimbo Fisher probably is not a listener of this program. However, we do have listeners of this program who are prayerful, and my suggestion to you is to pray that his heart is loosened and it's open to that phone call. And my guess, he's eventually going to do it, but let's pray he does it sooner than later.
Yeah.
By the way, they play each other again. And a little side note to the rivalry here. They're not only both in the SEC, right? But Alabama had one loss going into the playoff last year before they lost to Georgia in the final game of the season, and they lost the national championship to Georgia. But Chris, you may recall this from a previous show. There have been 20-plus attempts by former assistants under Nick Saban, who are now head coaches. They all previously failed to beat him. Some of them multiple times, right? Some of these guys, you know, have tried multiple times to beat Alabama.
Right.
When Jimbo Fisher beat Alabama for their only loss this past year, 2021, it was the first time a former assistant coach beat Nick Saban.
Right.
So there's probably something there as well about that rivalry. So I've given you folks something good to pray on. Now, one of the things I mentioned from the very beginning of the show, I saw this question posed to the reader of this newspaper I was reading, and it said, can there be too much Tiger Woods coverage? Chris, let's say the answer at the very same time. Ready? 3, 2, 1, yes. And we did not practice that.
No. Nope.
There is so much coverage on this guy. It's puzzling to me. I don't quite understand it. I was trying to talk it through with Ed last time. I was trying to talk it with a former guest I remember just a couple weeks ago, Tim. And his name is Tim Hill. He's a sports guy as well. And he was basically defending Tiger Woods and his importance in golf. But Chris and I are at least in agreement there that there is the question needs to be answered. Can there be too much Tiger Woods coverage? And the answer is yes. All right, listen, we have less than a minute. But Chris, do the quick Q&A and let me give a quick answer on this.
Okay. The quick Q&A is the USFL is underway. Your first impression.
So first of all, what is the USFL? It's the United States Football League.
Right.
And it's restarting after a 30-plus year hiatus. It was in the 80s, right? In fact,
right.
Steve Young, the Hall of Fame great, he was in the USFL. There was a lot of good players in that inaugural season. And they're trying to swipe a piece of the pro football pie. There's the XFL. There's the CFL. Right. Now there's the USFL trying to come again. It's okay. There's some decent players. But, Chris, what surprised me most, have you even caught a glimpse of this on TV?
No, I haven't had a chance to.
Chris, there's less than 1,000 people in the stands. In fact, the one game I saw had less than 500. And here's why there's an issue. If you have no fans, there's going to be lack of excitement.
Right.
If you have lack of excitement in the game, nobody's going to watch.
Right.
We're going to wait to see what happens with this USFL, brother, but I don't think they're going very far.
No, I was hoping they would do a little bit better than the XFL did.
I know.
I mean, the XFL tried twice, but it didn't work.
And they're coming back again, I think.
Yeah,
right?
More third time.
I think COVID has delayed that.
I guess they're three strikes, and we'll see if they're
that's
out.
That's right. That's right. We'll see if they're out. Folks, thank you for listening to Faith and Sport today. You're listening to Carolina Catholic Radio or Carolina Catholic Media. It's a co-production of Radio Maria. Before we go, I want to thank Carlos Herrera. Chris, thank you for everything you do for the show each and every day. I'm Dr. John Aquaviva. Please join us next time here on Carolina Catholic Radio and Radio Maria for Faith and Sport. St. Sebastian, pray for us.
You've been listening to Faith and Sport on the Carolina Catholic Radio Network, 1270 AM Charlotte. Also streaming at CarolinaCatholicMedia.org and on the Carolina Catholic Media app. We're also a co-production of Radio Maria, so thank you to all of our Radio Maria listeners for tuning in for Faith and Sport today. And make sure you tune in again next week for more Faith and Sport. And also, when you go on to CarolinaCatholicMedia.org or on the Carolina Catholic Media app to listen to Faith and Sport, make sure you hit that Donate Now button to help keep Carolina Catholic Radio and Media on the air and streaming, and Faith and Sports on the air.